हेलो एवरीवन। सॉरी, आई वाज लुकिंग एट माय क्लॉक ऑन द वॉल एंड इट आई थिंक दिस सेल्स आर रनिंग वीक, सो इट इज नॉट शोइंग मी। आई जस्ट चेक्ड अप, आई एम 8 मिनट लेट टुडे। आर यू हियर? आई डोंट हियर एनीथिंग। हेलो।
Hello, good afternoon, ma'am.
Okay, so you guys are here because I can only see names. I don't hear any sound. Are we ready for today's class?
Yes, ma'am.
This is going to be our last week. I have used option of virtual background. I'm trying to see how it works. We tried this. How many of you can use the virtual background? You tried this option? I'm using a green dupatta in my background to project this lovely outside. Sitting inside, you feel to get outside. So this is what I'm doing. I think I can decrease. Okay. So right, we should be going back to our DB Act. And some of the definitions we need to have a look at. We need to go back. We were here, the definition of aggrieved person, I think, last class. Today we are planning to look at some more clauses and then these two cases. Have you read those two cases, Batra versus Batra and Hiral Harsoria?
Yes, ma'am.
Great. So let's look at these definitions. Aggrieved person, we knew. We know a very category. It says any woman. It has to be a female member. Has it to be a wife only?
No, ma'am. She can even be related to like blood or by consanguinity.
Right.
So she need not be the wife.
Yeah, she can be a sister. She can be a daughter. But what is important is that this person, this woman, should be in a domestic relationship. And this is the definition, and we made a distinction between lived and stayed. So when you go and visit a relative, you only stay there, you don't live there. But if a person has gone to, suppose a niece of the family has come to live here in order to pursue her LLB degree for 3 years, then she's living, then she's not only staying. But when we live in a rented PG house, PG accommodation, for example, we are, even though we might be living there in for 3 years, it will not be living together because there we are all living in our own rooms and we are only staying together. So that distinction is very important in order to understand what are the places which can come within the domestic relationship. But first of all, there's no domestic relationship with people. You stay in the PG. These are only people who are staying in that household, but they're not living together in a shared household. So the shared household is the most important definition and which is relevant for our purposes of today's discussion in Batra versus Batra. And Anjali, do you want to read it? Anjali, are you here? I do not know. No, I'm not seeing the list. Are you here? Asta, who is here? Whoever is here can speak, can read.
Shared household. A household where the person aggrieved lives or at any stage has lived in a domestic relationship, either singly or along with the respondent. And includes such a household whether owned or tenanted either jointly by the aggrieved person and the respondent, or owned or tenanted by either of them, in respect of which either the aggrieved person or the respondent, or both jointly or singly, have any right, title, interest, or equity, and includes such a household which may belong to the joint family of which the respondent is a member, irrespective of whether the respondent or the aggrieved person has any right, title, or interest in the shared household.
Okay, great. So, what is it that we are learning from here, and what we get a sense of? Which part of the definition is the substantive part, and which part are the explanatory part? Can you make a distinction in reading of this whole definition? A household where the person aggrieved lives or at any stage has lived in a domestic relationship, either singly or along with the respondent. Then it says and includes, and there is another and includes. So when it says includes in any definition, what does it mean? Is that explanatory in nature or that exhaustive in nature?
Explanatory.
They're explaining the substantive part, which is the first three lines. A household where a person aggrieved lives or at any stage has lived in a domestic relationship, either singly or along with the respondent. So whether the explanations limit the scope, you know, these are examples, these are explanations, these are exhaustive, these are the questions which we need to consider after we have looked at Batra versus Batra. And the importance of the shared household is section 17, which gives the right of residence in the shared household to the woman, the aggrieved woman. So notwithstanding anything contained in any other law for the time being in force, every woman in a domestic relationship shall have the right to reside in the shared household, whether or not she has any right, title, or beneficial interest in the same. Aggrieved person shall not be evicted or excluded from the shared household or any part of it by the respondent, save in accordance with the procedure established by law. So now tell us, what are the facts in Batra versus Batra? Sunny, you want to give them the facts of this case? Are you here?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, tell us.
This is about... I will say just summary part of this. Tarun Batra and Amit Batra was husband living in along with her mother and father. Mm-hmm. It was, the house was on the name of Amit's mother. Mm-hmm. And there was a divorce filed by Amit, and then Taruna Batra has...
When Amit filed the divorce, where was Mrs. Batra living?
Because of dispute, she was shifted to her matrimony.
So first
Her father's home.
First she was thrown out, then he files for divorce, and then...
It was alleged that she filed counterfiled.
He also moved. Okay, she filed a counter complaint of DV.
Under 498A and other sections.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so.
And then what did Mr. Batra do? Amit Batra do?
Yeah, Mr. Batra's family is like.
Mr. Batra did.
Mr. Batra, actually there are two parties. Appellant is actually the mother of Amit Batra.
I know.
And she has closed her house for Taruna Batra. And mm-hmm. Amit Batra has shifted in some other rented accommodation.
So he files for divorce, she files for domestic violence, he shifts out. He starts living in Ghaziabad. And now Karuna Batra is saying, I have a right of residence in Amit Batra's mother's house where I live together with him.
Yes.
Right. So Mrs. Batra is saying, the mother Batra is saying, I am the sole owner of this property. I took it, this property, with loan, and it is exclusively my property. It is not a joint family property. And therefore, Karuna Batra has got no right of residence in this property. Are there any other relevant facts? She even
went to the court for taking a temporary injunction on the second floor of that particular property.
Mm-hmm.
And the other party claimed that if she was not living in that property, then how can she claim the suit for injunction in that property?
I think that was the argument given by judge.
Yeah, so ultimately whether the issue was whether in these circumstances is she entitled to live in that household. And what the judge has said as an answer?
Answer, judge has not given in favor of Karuna Batra. Decision was no.
Mm-hmm. And what is the reason given by the judge?
Because she was, at the time of dispute, she was not living in that house. And she was living with in her paternal home.
Yeah, so that's one of the reasons. What are the other reasons?
The judge also, so she took, she went on to claim that she has the right of residence in section 1719. But the judge said that it doesn't matter that wherever you have stayed it does not become your matrimonial home or does not become the domestic relationship. So there's also an example given in the almost in the last parallel judgment. The judge has said that, for example, if you have stayed in some relative's place, it will not become your shared household, and that there's a difference between staying and living.
Mm-hmm. That's a very good point.
But that is
very textual view of the shared household meaning, because what I felt that during the time of this marriage, the same house was shown as a house of the Amit and not only of that mother.
Yeah.
And now,
but
at the time
nowhere
of
the facts.
And at the time of dispute, now it's become his mother's house and not his. So, and the rented accommodation, she cannot go and claim. So ultimately, she was evicted from all the places and she has nowhere to go.
Yeah, but what
the judge also said that the wife is only entitled to claim residence in a shared household, so which belongs to the husband, or if it is a joint family property. In the particular case, it belonged to appellant number 2, which is the mother of Amit Batra. So she cannot claim, she can claim from the husband, but not from the mother and father or the relative of the husband.
So is this reasoning supported by the legislation? The section that we looked at. Is this what the
I think it's
says?
A very textual interpretation. It's not look the substantive part of the legislation.
No, but we need to look at the textual words also, no? Whether the textual words. What are the textual words? This is the text, no? Of house, the definition of shared household. Where does this text say? And it means, no? Look at the judgment. The words used by the judge are. Judge says in 17, a shared household would mean, right? There's a distinction between the manner in which we interpret the word mean and the word and the usage of the word include. So what did the definition of shared household say? Include or mean?
Include.
And this says include, which means it is only an example. It is not exhaustive of what is all included in the definition. But where has the judge gone? It says shared household would mean only the household belonging to or taken by rent, taken on rent. Now look at the definition, the shared household definition. What did it say? The household where the person adhered lives or at any stage has lived. It does not say at the time of dispute they should be living, right? Yeah. It's at any stage has lived in a domestic relationship, either singly or along with the respondent. Suppose the husband was in the army and he was actually only visiting the household, but he has been on a non-family station. So she lived alone in the household of the parents-in-law. Will that household be called as a shared household or not? The husband wasn't living there because he's on a non-family station. Or it may be also that because of the children being in a school and they didn't want to shift the school. So even when the husband was on a family station, the woman stayed back. Will she be said to be living in a shared household or not? The husband got his own residence in the family station, but the wife hasn't moved there. She visits him on the weekends, on long vacations with the children. But because of the student, the child being, let's say, the child is in the 10th standard or in a board exam or whatever, the school is not good at the place of posting. There may be 1,000 reasons because of which the wife did not go with the husband when he was on the, was getting transferred at various places. It may be army men, it can be anyone. So if the husband's job is transferable and she doesn't move along with him and she stays back in the in-laws' house, will that be a shared household or not shared household? When it says she had lived there either singly or along with the respondent and includes, does it say and means such a household? Because this is what the judge is saying, that it is a household, it, the word shared household means only two categories. One, when it is rented property, when it is the joint family property, only then. But is that interpretation supported by this language of the section of the of this definition? So if it is not, so do you think it is a just interpretation of the definition of section 17?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
So why? Anyone else apart from you two? What do the others think? And the judge has got, has given us other reasons also. What did he say? First of all, he gives us the facts. So this was the argument it already mentioned. Has shifted also. This is all the facts. Then single judge, what did he say? Taking for other property was the matrimonial home of Taruna Batra. He further held that even if her husband Amit Batra has shifted to Ghaziabad, that would not make Ghaziabad the matrimonial home of Srimati Taruna Batra. Learned judge was of the view that mere change of the residence by the husband would not shift the matrimonial home from Ashok Vihar, particularly when the husband had filed a divorce divorce petition against his wife. And on this reasoning, he permitted her to be there. With respect, we are unable to agree with the view of the High Court. And why have they said so? One of the things they said was that we do not have a legislation like British Matrimonial Homes Act 1967. And in any case, means that even if you had, unless you have a, so this is one, we do not have a similar law, which says the British Matrimonial Homes. The rights which may be available under any law can only be as against the husband and not against the father-in-law or mother-in-law. What does that mean? And in any case, from where is the statement coming? This is the judge's viewpoint. that the married woman can have rights against husbands, not against the in-laws. And in this case, once he has made up his mind on this one, he is finding the definitions to interpret in a manner which suits his viewpoint, isn't that? Mm-hmm. So even we do not have this title of Matrimonial Homes Act. Even in England, if they have created a law like that, say that no, you have a right of residence there. In India, where we have patrilocal families, we are still ignoring the language of the law. So what will be the rationale for the judge to ignore the language of the law? The household in question belongs to the mother-in-law and it does not belong to her husband, Amit Batra. And what did the definition say? Such a household which may belong to the joint family with the respondent is a member, irrespective of whether the respondent or the aggrieved person has any right, title, or interest in the shared household. So he had an interest, at least he was also living in that household. And even if he had none, it still would be included. So the household which may belong to the joint family, which the respondent is a member. So one, the opening words are includes, does not say mean, as a starting point. And even in the included category, household is only the building which belongs to the joint family or the household which is a joint family household and respondent is a member. There was a possibility of even asking that question, that whether the respondent, whether if they suppose respondent was living at that point of time with them. Suppose he was not living in a separate household. He was living in that household. Whether she would have a right to residence in that household or not. In the same household where mother-in-law is the owner of the property. Suppose the husband has
the right.
Suppose
ma'am, this is Vivek. So, I have a point here. There is a case after that for this scenario also. If the husband, like Amit and Taruna, were staying there, and there was a fight between Amit and his mother, right? Mm. And Amit has been asked to move out, right? Can still Taruna file a case and say that I want to stay in the same house? Because this is the case happened in another case in domestic violence.
Yeah, I know that. What we are asking now, just now, is that in case Amit had not moved out of the house, he was still living in the same household, will the judge, by this interpretation, even then she cannot claim residence as long as...
Because he's only focusing...
That is irrelevant. Whether he's living with the same, with the mother or living apart. We will talk about the mother being harassed. Hiral does talk about that also to some extent. We'll come to that.
Yeah.
But at this point of time, if you go by Batra versus Batra, then even when the son is living with the mother in the same household owned by the mother, the wife is not entitled to live there. That's the implication of what Batra is saying. Because she has a right of residence only the husband's house. So, if he's living in a rented accommodation, if he's paying the rent or she's paying the rent, she can't be thrown out. So, in the tenanted property, it doesn't matter. But in the household of his mother, because the house belongs to his mother, she has no right of residence. So, now compare this scenario to a play. He is saying matrimonial home. He files a restitution of conjugal rights. Will the judge say, he doesn't have a matrimonial house? He doesn't have his own house. He is living in his mother's house. Therefore, the woman can't be asked to go and join. Will any judge ever say that? If he files a restitution conjugal rights suit living in his mother's house, the judge will say, that is not a matrimonial house. She doesn't have an obligation to go and live there. So that house will remain a matrimonial home when it comes to restitution of conjugal rights. but it will not be a shared household for her when it comes to domestic violence. What double standards? What is happening in the judge's mind? What is he thinking?
Ma'am, he has failed to recognize the sociological pattern prevailing in India, where it is common
for sons to recite. Why is the question? Why has he failed to do so?
So, ma'am, what will be the remedy in case, in this way, if like in all India, in marriages and all across India, sociological perspective, people want to do marriage?
Vivek, your voice is breaking.
Ma'am, I will write the question and thank you.
Yeah.
Ma'am, I think the judge, like, if he's doing such interpretation, it is clearly because she is because there's already divorce petition going on. Why to give residence to a woman who will be divorced?
Who knows?
And why to give a residence in that place?
But how do we know? How we are prejudging the divorce matter?
Maybe like it can be like a maybe situation, like he's thinking of she's not entitled to claim that from the, though it's a matrimonial home, but still she cannot claim the right of residence.
And even Judge Katju has been criticized by many sociologists and other legal experts that he do not take the substantive aspect and only look at the law very textually.
So what we are coming to is that it is not, because what we were looking in 498A, 304B, the limitations in the sections. Now we are coming, the section doesn't have a limitation, but the judge's mind has a limitation.
Yeah.
He is also, kind of, perhaps he has come across women who have made a false complaint, who had been harassing a male family member around people he knows. Who knows what all has prevailed in his mind, but it is certainly not the language of the section which has prevailed when he interpreted it. He's interpreting it as to his understanding of that a woman cannot have a right, any right against the in-laws. She can have rights only against the husband. That's what his stated position is. And he's finding ways and means to substantiate that position. So 17 and 19, while disposing of an application under subsection 1 of section 12, the magistrate may pass a residence order restraining the respondent from dispossessing or in any other manner disturbing the possession of the aggrieved person from shared household, directing the respondent to remove himself from the shared household, restraining the respondent. So all these good provisions of restraints and directions are of no use if you throw out the very right in the first place by looking at the depth. These sections will be of any use to a woman only if she can qualify her residence as being in a shared household as given in section 2. If that definition itself is restricted, then none of this is of any use. So all the argument which the petitioners made were thrown out because of the manner in which he has interpreted the section completely, apparently on the face of it, contrary to the language of the section. Section does not use the word anywhere that it means so and so. Then this point which I think Asta was making earlier, live together in dozen places. He doesn't make a distinction between visiting friends and families and grandparents and uncles and aunties and living in those places. He doesn't have an understanding. He's not, showing an understanding of the distinction between the two types of residences, where you go and visit some people and places where you live. What does it say? All these houses of the husband relatives shall be shared households, and the wife can well insist on living in all these houses of her husband's relatives merely because she had stayed with her husband for some time. He himself is using the word stayed with her husband for some time. How does it become living? We have no understanding. So it is certainly the judge has not thought through his ideas, but being a Supreme Court has a very, very severe impact on the legislation's scope. So the claim for alternative accommodation can only be made against the husband and not against the in-laws. Shared household would mean only the household belonging to or taken on rent by husband, or the house which belongs to the joint family of which the husband is a member. The property in question in the present case neither belongs to Amit Batra, nor was it taken on rent by him, nor is it a joint family property of which husband Amit Batra is a member. So certainly, it is not a joint family property, that we got no questions about. Factual information is correct. But whether the section said that it must, that the husband must have any interest, should be a member, and whether it is included, whether the word included is equivalent to mean. It is exclusive property of appellant number two, the mother, hence it cannot be called a shared household. The judge has not examined the definition at all. He has looked at 17, has looked at 19, but has he quoted the section 2 definition of shared household? Has he analyzed the words even in that definition? He's not even looked at He has not analyzed the words in the definition itself. He's just going by his own understanding of what may be shared household. But that's not what it is about. That's not the purpose of the definition. So very categorically, the judge in this case has not analyzed the relevant section itself. He's gone on his own thinking. Certainly, this is not an example where one can say that the language of the section was faulty. This is an example where the judge has not even looked at the relevant section. And that's another challenge we have to deal with when you're talking about laws made for women. Unless the mindset changes, unless the trainings are there, unless awareness there, unless empathy is there to the cause, you will find ways and means even when the section doesn't permit it.
But sir, in this case, this counsel also not defended or given proper argument. Well, judges was making this kind of statement.
We do not know what happened, because what we do know is that section 2 definition of shared household has not been given in this judgment, and which was the key to the whole interpretation. Whether the lawyer did not mention it or it was not provided, we do not know. We'll join in the second meeting. We need to stop here.